Now, everything old is new again. America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
Now, usually it takes me two or three takes just to warm up, but tonight I predict we'll get it on the first take.
We always get it on the first take. We have to.
You do?
Sure, this is live television.
Live? What does live mean?
It means at the exact moment you're cavorting and leaping around that stage over there, 20 million people are seeing it.
But wait a minute.
Wait a minute. Mr. Swan, you're white.
You mean it all goes into the camera lens and then just spills out into people's houses?
Welcome to Everything Old is New Again. That's Peter O'Toole in My Favorite Year from 1982. And we are here, Douglas Viviani here, with the rather lively David Cohen.
Yes, we are, Doug.
And we're broadcast live to tape, if you will. And we're going to investigate live television today, talking about the successful experiment of 2013's live performance, which started the ball rolling of live plays of The Sound of Music with Carrie Underwood, 2014's not so successful Peter Pan, 2015 The Wiz Live, and most recently a couple months back Grease Live was broadcast, and
hence my singing my greeting.
Exactly, live TV is back, but that's nothing new. TV has been live since its infancy. In what year?
We shouldn't be live for that reason.
Exactly.
You heard it.
Thank you. 1936, broadcasting the Summer Olympics, which held Jesse Owens in Berlin. Remember that? Until 58.
No, I don't, Doug.
No, but those years, it was live. It was live even through the 60s. We still have some live TV today. We got Dancing with the Stars and some portions of American Idol, The Voice, America's Got Talent, some of that stuff. But these live Broadway musicals seem to be making a comeback, at least apparently here one a year. We've got The Passion, which was just broadcast as well.
Who?
Live, The Passion, the musical. So, it's back. I mean, I don't know. What do you think? You happy to see it back or what?
I think it's pretty interesting. And I say that because I'm not necessarily a huge fan of Broadway musicals. I've seen some really good ones, definitely. But I just saw Book of Mormon recently. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's amazing. Anyway, I'm not a big fan, but when Grease was on, I actually said, all right, let me check this out, you know? And I ended up watching about half of it because I was just fascinated by how they were able to pull this off on live television with the sets, with the whole bit. Very impressive. I liked it.
Yeah, they went out of their way, too. They were on a lot there. I can't remember if it was Universal or Paramount, but they had the run of the lot inside and out. So it wasn't just on a play on
right.
a stage.
Right.
They were running all over the place with golf carts from scene to scene, and it was really done well, I have to tell you. And we're going to talk about that a little later on in this particular show. But first, I want to welcome KLTF 960 AM on Sunday, I guess you'd say mornings or afternoons, 12 AM. 12 PM. So that's, you know, that's Sunday
that's
afternoon.
Better. Yeah.
Yes. And we're broadcasting there. We're very happy to be broadcasting in Little Falls, Minnesota, which is basically we're broadcasting the entire county of Morrison County.
Awesome.
And we're
welcome.
Trying to learn a little bit about your area out there, Morrison. So if you've got something that you're proud of, and I'm sure you are, certainly lots of things, but we're not aware of, and it's not on Wikipedia, send us a note. We'd love to revisit this topic of your hometown, and let's hear that on oldnewagain@aol.com. oldnewagain@aol.com. Send us the notes. By the way, I don't know if you saw for sale there. They've got 15,000 acres for sale
in Morrison County.
Yeah, for $2 million.
$2 million for 1,500 acres. That's a lot of land.
1,500 or 15,000.
1,500, I think it was.
1,500.
1,500, sorry. So if you do buy that land
right.
and do a home every half an acre, that's 3,000 homes,
right.
you'll... And sell them
and
all.
Sell them for how much? Like 200
figure
grand?
Like 200,000 each? That's 60 million.
600 million.
Whoa, it's a lot of money.
It is.
600 million?
Why aren't we doing this?
Figure take 100 million off of your cost for you know, building.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money.
It is. Why are we sitting here?
I don't know. Especially right. now that Everything Old is New Again is broadcasting.
Thanks for listening, everyone.
Morrison.
Have a good night.
Exactly. We can make our own city. It'll be Everything Old is New Again Town or Vivsville or something like that. And we'll be sitting high.
Vivsville.
Yeah, you like that?
Yeah, it's so easy to say. Where do you live?
Vivsville. Vivsville. That's pretty much what I do every day. You know, you're calling. I call in, like, you know, and you've got to order something on the phone or whatever. Right. You got to say your last name. I got to go. V as in Victor. I, another V, another I, A N I. I just, you can't.
They can't.
Like
they can't understand Viviani.
No.
Won't.
And what do you? What do you? You just say Cohen, and people write it down, right? They don't ask.
Well, even that is a little confusing.
It is.
Yeah.
All right.
Cohen, C-O-N-E, like the pitcher, David Cohen. Yeah. Yeah, that's it. You got it.
Anyway, let's. I love that accent. This fellow's got a very distinctive accent, too, from the 1940s. Ed Wynn talking about the infancy of live television.
I am speaking to all the people who are standing in front of television stores looking at this show through the window. Please do not lean against the glass.
And that's a little comedy there, if you will, starting the ball rolling on live TV. He was live.
Oh, so he was implying that people are watching outside of a store that sells TVs?
Right, so that was happening in the 30s and 40s, a brand new thing. People didn't want to invest. There's not much on television because,
right.
Yeah, well, you know, it was just starting. So he was on, and he was distinctive, and they were starting to sell TVs, and people would walk by and see this, and that's what he's talking
and
about.
And the point is that everything was broadcast live,
and
but there was no
was
tape.
Live. And we're talking about plays. There was a Playhouse 90 back in the 50s, 1955 to 1960, in that era. And they did plays just like they're doing now, but they did these dramas. So listen, tell me if you figure out whose story.
Playhouse 90, tonight starring Jack Palance, Susie Parker, also starring...
Listen to that music.
I love the music.
Jack Palance, who
Jack Palance, yeah, doing the push-ups and the Academy Awards. Well,
there you go. Okay, he was also in the two movies on the ranch there with Billy Crystal.
Right, right, yeah. All that's right. When he did it.
And he was known for doing plays with them, and he was very good. He did, before Requiem for a Heavyweight was done with Jackie Gleason, if you remember that, that's, you know, a different... presentation. You
right.
may not remember that show, but before it was done, that's very famous that we've talked about in the past. He did it live. Requiem for a Heavyweight on Playhouse 90.
But I was almost a heavyweight champion of the world. I'm a big ugly slob and I look like a freak, but I was almost a heavy. You know, I'd like to put that down on that piece of paper. This is no punk. This is a guy who is almost the heavyweight champion of the world.
That's how I got this job. I say, you know, I was a big, ugly slob. Right? What did he say? It was a great quote.
I couldn't help but hear Mandelbaum, right? Wasn't Jack Palance? Mandelbaum.
No, that wasn't him. That was a different actor.
Really? Yes. Oh, it would have been so good
but
if it was him.
But you could hear, though, the live TV. You could hear how terrific it is to see live performance.
See, this is where you're finally, you know, talking about history on our show that actually has some relevance to the topic. I like this. I like it.
Well, let's continue with Abbott Costello and just to take a look at, by the way, this is them live on the Colgate Comedy Hour.
You know, you ask me a lot of silly questions. Why don't you ask me a nice question instead of the hard one?
All right, will you answer it before we start?
Yeah, no, a nice question.
All right, say you have $5 in this pants pocket and $5 in that pants pocket. What have you got?
Somebody else's pants on.
There you are.
There you go. They were great live. They would... brought up live, doing live performances on vaudeville, and that translated beautifully in the 50s to the Colgate Comedy Hour, which they were on for quite a bit, and made that a big hit. So the idea is there's been a lot of live television until recently. We've only got lately Saturday Night Live and a couple other shows. So we'll come back and examine this and see, is live TV coming back?
Sunday,
listen to that, the way they all that live music and live performance.
It was pretty amazing. I mean, for such a primitive means of communication at the time, they really pulled out all the stops.
And they were doing, it had to be timed. They had to get out on the commercials on time. They had
right.
to, you know, have
right.
their skits. They had to get the show over on time. They had to time it. They had a week to do it. I mean, if you watch My Favorite Year, that movie, I think it really brings it to life. There's a lot of movies that've done this, but that, if you remember, with Peter O'Toole,
I never saw it. No,
oh,
I
can't
have
believe I've seen that. It's just it's supposed to be your show of shows with Sid Caesar.
Oh, okay.
And it really brings, and it's a reluctant star, Peter O'Toole, who's kind of a drunk, and he's a star of movies. But as you heard in the beginning of our show, you know, his clip is he's like, what? This is live. He didn't really realize he was going to be performing live. He's like, I'm not an actor. I do lines for movies. If I met mess it up, I could do it again. Right. So anyway, live TV is interesting. We're going to go through the next section, watching and hearing live television at its best. And I think when you think of live TV, do you think of any particular actor or people or comedian that comes to life or show that you enjoy live?
The only show that I think of right now is Saturday Night Live. I didn't realize that there are other shows that are done live. When you mentioned Dancing with the Stars, and you're right, that there are portions of that are done live. So, right. No, I mean, other than Saturday Night Live, no.
Well, also, you've got some that are live taped to broadcast. Well, they could edit
that's different.
It in, but they don't really change. Like the Letterman Show when it was done, or, you know, Jimmy Fallon, they're not really editing much. They've got it down. That's live, what you've seen
that's
on
true.
TV.
Right.
Unless they make a huge mistake, that's live.
Right.
So, but it's live for tape.
By the way, Lloyd Bridges, you're right, was the Mandelbaum, not Jack Palance.
Yes. Everything old is new again. We'll be right back.
This is Sunday. It's Holgate Funday when you meet.
You're listening to Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
This is Terrence Winter, writer and executive producer of The Sopranos, creator and executive producer of Boardwalk Empire and The New Vinyl on HBO. And you're listening to my friends Douglas Viviani and David Cohen on Everything Old is New Again.
Listen to those credits. Isn't that great?
I know. We're his friends.
Yeah, in addition to that, from now on, when he's doing another show, another interview, he does that credit, and he's adding on to that now, and friends of Douglas Viviani and David Cohen from Everything Old is New Again. He's going to promote us along with Vinyl, which is...
Sure, yeah.
I'm actually going to try to ask him to do that. That would be funny, wouldn't it?
It would be funny to see his reaction when you ask him, yeah.
He'll give me the bill for dinner is what he'll do, I think. Sneak away if he's fast as he could. Anyway... we're discussing live TV, and is it coming back? We've seen quite a bit of that recently. Let's take a look at live TV at its best. Listen to a clip it's kind of hard to get, you know, Saturday Night Live type skits into, like, you know, 3 seconds, 10 seconds, 20 seconds to hear what it was like. But this is a husband comes home, Sid Caesar from work. His wife thinks he is forgotten.
This is Show of Shows we're listening to?
Yes, Show of Shows. This is the skit. Is the wife thinks he's forgotten the birthday.
Okay.
And here's kind of the payoff. Hopefully.
There you are. There it is. The earrings. Saved up a whole year. There they are. As a present. Happy birthday.
Fine way to give a present. It's typical of you to just sort of throw them at me.
Yeah.
Like you throw a bone at a dog. Like,
yeah.
It's so typical of you to do something like this. They're beautiful.
Yeah.
He's all upset because after like 15 minutes before this of arguing back and forth of her, you know, him keeping the secret and her arguing that he's forgotten the birthday. Very creative, very clean. But I was never a fan of your Show of Shows and Sid Caesar growing up in the 70s and 80s and 60s just because it was not my time, you know. But
right.
They've released them on YouTube and on discs. If you go back and watch them, they're timeless.
Yeah.
And this guy really was a genius.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Because you'll see him later on, and like he's in the, the Vegas animal.
The vacation movie.
And it's just not, it's a shadow of the guy.
I won the money. I won the money.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I don't know, he was good enough, but he was a shadow of this guy that I think was made to perform live.
Yes, I agree.
You have got to see what he does.
I didn't realize you can actually buy the discs.
I did for my dad a little ways back, and I actually asked him to. I actually bought one for myself, and I gave it to my dad when he goes to Florida every year. And I said, "Let me have him back when you come back from Florida." It's been about 4 years. I haven't gotten it back. He loves it so much. It's a pretty large anthology of them.
Good to know.
So you know, I don't know. It's hard to translate on the radio here, but if you ever get a chance, that guy. And that show was so well written. It was wonderful. And they did the skits. Like you say, Saturday Night Live skits sometimes last too long. We did a show on Saturday Night Live. We talked about that.
Right.
His skits, they could be 15, 20 minutes, and they're all hysterical. Some of them are short.
Huh.
But it's so well written. Let's listen to something else that happened in 1963 live on television.
There is Leon.
He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's the man with a gun.
I'm not saying
panic.
That's the best
absolute
of
panic
them.
Here in the basement of Dallas Police Headquarters.
It's just
what's
chaos.
That beat? What was that music?
Yeah,
I don't know.
But
you really brought the show to a complete standstill
exactly.
Now. Thanks for that.
That's why I tried to talk over and ignore it. But the point being is, I mean, that's not the best of, but it's the best of in that you're right there on live TV watching someone get assassinated.
Right. And they didn't rehearse that. You know, you have to get it right. Ruby had to get it right that first time because they couldn't call cut. It just, you know, wouldn't be the surprise.
But how insane is that? That's live TV. And I think, talk about back to comedians. I mean, you've got live TV sports all the time as well, which we can get into. But, you know, there's so much great things that have gone on in live TV. Listen to this and tell me if...
what are you going to play, the Hindenburg next?
You remember Friday's TV show in 1980s?
Fridays,
like
yes.
Saturday Night Live. Kaufman went on there. And in this skit is Michael Richards and...
Kramer.
And they did a skit, and Andy Kaufman pulled one of his usual routines. Live TV. Middle of the skit.
I can't play stoned. I feel a little stupid.
You can stupid. That's just great. You feel stupid.
I feel very stupid.
You feel stupid.
Look, I'm just trying to have everybody so uptight around here. Everyone's so uptight around here. I don't understand.
I don't know if you can get the flavor of it on, you know, you're not seeing it, but it was in that movie, Man on the Moon, about Andy Kaufman. And when you see it, what it was is he was supposed to play, you know, at a dinner party or at a restaurant. He was supposed to be high and hungry and whatever. And he was saying, I just can't do it. Michael Richards got so upset. He went up off stage. He grabbed the cue cards for what the character was supposed to say, threw it on the table and said, just read these. Legitimately upset. Then one of the producers of the show had to come along, and it was a fist of cuffs, and they had to cut to commercial. All live TV, and everyone believed that was legit, actually happening right then and there, until the following week when Andy Kaufman came on and issued an apology.
I want you to know the truth. The truth is, this was an experimental piece. We wanted to do something different. At one point, we were supposed to digress from the script, and I can't do this. I won't do it. I won't say it. I can't say it. Sorry.
It's hard to do. It's long. But basically, they had him on to apologize. And then he reading this piece of paper, rips it up and basically says, I can't do this. It's a lie. We didn't plan this in advance. This is just something that I did as an improv to get this live performance on its edge, to try to get these actors. You could hear them, how uncomfortable they were,
right,
and all this.
It definitely did not sound originally like it's all a setup, like a... trying to pull one over.
Right. But now Michael Richards to this day now says it was a setup, and all that was Andy Kaufman in his perfect, you know, way that he presents it. It's still a question. Did he do that live and mess up that skit on purpose? Did he do, you know, as part of everyone knowing that? Or did no one know it? He just planned to do it himself?
It's a great thing about live TV, because it's sort of like watching a car race. If you're not a race fan, you're watching partially to see if there's a crash, right?
And with him, he was a genius with this. I'm sorry, I have to use that word like so
yes.
casually, but
yep.
he was with live TV. He was
remember
so
what he did
creative.
On Letterman with Jerry Lawler?
I don't remember that, but maybe this will bring our memory back.
You're
really?
Full of my friend. I will sue you for everything you have. I will sue you as far as I'm concerned. You hear me? I am sorry. I am sorry to use those words on television. I apologize to all my friends. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. But you're a
I think you can use some of those words on TV. I'm not...
I remember seeing that live, but you introduced that one. Tell us what
I
that
didn't
was
even
about.
Know you were going to play
right.
that. That's really cool.
Perfect timing.
Yeah, so he got into this apparently real fight with a wrestler, Jerry Lawler. Jerry Lawler slapped Andy Kaufman. I mean, it was a real slap, and it hurt him.
Right on the interview.
Right
on,
there on Letterman.
TV,
yeah. Yeah. And apparently the whole thing was a setup. It wasn't, right. It didn't really,
But do you remember watching it? I remember watching
yes,
it live.
I do too.
Okay. Now, of course it's live to tape, but they didn't edit
right.
it. That was the guest. That was the show. They let it
yeah.
go. And it was acted so well that you really thought that this was legit, that these two were fighting on the
right.
air, because they had a history of this, and the histrionics was going back and forth, and then they cut to a break and came back, and Andy Kaufman was threw water on him and screaming and cursing and everything else. I mean, he knew that his forte was putting people on there. He didn't tell jokes. He wasn't a stand-up comedian.
Right.
He wasn't really a character actor. He did a lot of that stuff on Taxi, which he kind of didn't like, which I still think was great stuff.
It was.
But he felt that his
forte like performance art.
It was a performance art. Right. And so he sometimes, if not all the times, only let one or two people know, like the producer maybe, know what was, or let him in maybe, know what was going to happen, and wanted to see the reaction of everybody else.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I think it's fun, but you have to have a lot of confidence to be able to do that.
You do. But he took advantage of the medium, right? The live medium. And he did what he wanted to do, and it worked.
I mean, on his special, you see this in the movie, he wanted people, back in the day, TVs were a little bit different, and once in a while, you'd see the TV reception go out, and or the picture just like kind of roll, if you call it that, if you've ever seen that back in the day.
Yeah.
So he made the producers of the show make his special do that, so that people would get up out of their seat, hit their TV, move the TV antennas. Remember, not everybody had cable back then.
Right.
And he moved the antennas to try to get the reception on that special.
Yeah.
And meanwhile,
it was great.
It was broadcast that way. We'll be back on Everything Old is New Again. Live on tape.
Live on tape.
Maybe.
Or is it?
Say, Charlie, why the arm in the sling?
Yeah, I walked straight into that busted street sign in front of Frank's Automat.
Well, you must have been really sore at him.
You said it, pal. I said, say, what's a big idea making a fella trip out there? I was going to sock him right in a kisser.
He's all wet. Why, you ought to sue him, Charlie.
I have half a mind to do just that. But where am I going to get that kind of dough?
Say, I know a fella just got me out of a big jam, and he didn't break the bank.
You don't say.
Yeah, the law officer, Douglas Viviani.
The law office of Douglas Viviani?
That's right, the law office of Douglas Viviani.
Viviani.
That's what I said, Viviani.
He a straight shooter?
He's a cat's meow.
He's on the up and up?
Doug's aces with me.
Is that so?
He's a bee's knees.
Well, that's just swell. You have his number?
You can call him at 631-681-1910 or email him at Viviani Law.com.
Wait, what was that last part?
What, email?
Yeah, what's email?
Viviani Law.com.
Now, back to America's entertainment pop culture talk show, Everything Old is New Again, with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
Scarface Al Capone may have built it, and nobody knows what's in it. Some say money, some say body, some say it's booby trap. And we're going to open it. What secret lies inside? It may be Scarface Al Capone's biggest secret, and we'll open it on live television.
Welcome to Everything Old is New Again. We're discussing live television, and I think this segment we'll just dive into some of the mistakes, some of the things that happen on live TV that we talk about. Andy Kaufman, his stuff was on purpose, but seemed to be a mistake. And these are real mistakes or real issues that happened on live TV that there's so many of them. I'm just going to get a little flavor to show what can happen if you do the wrong thing on live TV.
Right.
And that was Geraldo opening Al Capone's vault. You remember
made
that?
Such a big deal out of that in advance. It was all over the news, and you had to tune in. Who knew what was in Al Capone's vault?
There 36
was
going to be million big. People tuned
36
in.
36 million, which was a lot.
Yeah. I mean, right? Especially, yeah, I mean, just unbelievable to see a vault opened up, and this is what happened at the end of that. That was pretty cool.
Pointed about that, as I'm sure you are. This is one time in my life that a pot of gold would have been a lot more fun than chasing the rainbows. And I promised all the critics that if we didn't find anything, I'd sing a song. So Chicago, Chicago, that's Hotland Town. All right, I'm going. I'll see you.
And they just walked off.
Oof.
He was so embarrassed, brutal. So disgusted. And it's an interview that he says afterwards he went home, he got drunk, he was so upset and everything. And the next day he got like 20 offers to do other work. Because the power of live TV back
right.
in the day,
right.
you know, at that time, besides news, local news or local morning show, there was nothing
yeah,
live.
Yeah, because TV had moved into an era where, right, other than daytime soaps, some of which I believe were still live, but prime time, there was absolutely nothing live. Everything was video.
Right.
Everything.
So everybody was like, wow, this is going to be live. I mean,
it became
an event.
A thing, right. You had a tune. It was an appointment television at its
Except
finest.
Except for Saturday Night Live, which was the right. shtick of Saturday Night Live in the 70s, by the way. That's how they got on the air in some ways, was that, hey, this is going to be a live show. And that was a problem in the beginning. They didn't know, you know, that executives didn't know that it was going to work, and they didn't have any experience with it. It was just beyond them at that point. And then you get Sinead O'Connor on Saturday Night Live.
Oh, I'm sitting in my office, and the final part of the song is the camera slowly pushing into her face, and she brings out this photo of the Pope and tears it in half And I literally jumped out of my chair.
Fight the real enemy.
The air went out of the studio and he went, really?
And that was the end of her career. The lack of applause and the pin dropping was pretty much the end of her career because she did something really silly and stupid on live TV.
Which was, I don't know, did the listeners
you know,
really
the Pope
it?
Is usually a pretty popular guy.
No, I mean, did we really explain what she did?
Oh, that's true.
I don't know if it was apparent.
She sang a song and really was saying the real enemy of the world. And
she just ripped it. She held the photo up. I remember seeing that. I saw it live.
Yeah. I mean, they say that in the rehearsals, it was a picture of something else. They didn't know she was going to do that. And, you know, some things are just, especially back in that day, just beyond reproach. And the Pope was back in those days. I don't know if he is now, but certainly was then. And that was the end of her career. Silly move. This fellow's career is not ended, but he has a real, what would you call this, goose chills moment or a moment of real panic. A live TV, Peter Pan, Christopher Walken.
They found a mother. Oh, it's nice to have a mother. Mm. Peter Pan has found a mother. Oh, yeah. The game is up.
Oh, he forgot his line.
Yeah, he went up.
Struggling. And struggling, and no one like live. My wife performs a little bit. You perform when you're live performing, and someone forgets their line. Aren't you supposed to kind of try to maybe say their line a different way, or push them in the right direction, or remind them of the line?
Right, exactly.
Co-actors, just
nobody was helping him. That was a really sad thing. Nobody was helping him out.
Like they had to know what his line was. Whatever the heck.
Of course they do.
So you say the line. Oh wait a minute! Isn't Peter Pan coming? Or whatever the heck the line would be, and you get him going again.
That was bad.
Oh, so embarrassing. As was John Travolta at the Oscars.
Here to perform the Oscar-nominated, gorgeously empowering song, Let It Go, from the Oscar-winning animated movie Frozen, please welcome the wickedly talented one and only Adele Dazeem.
Idina Menzel, of course, is the name. And later on, I think what was some other award show, they had them together and he apologized. And he was rather awkward because he was holding her chin like for 30 seconds while he was saying.
Yeah, that was more awkward than him screwing up the name in the first place.
Exactly. And that was live, too. So, you know, these award shows, I guess some of them, I guess they all are live. The Oscars are live.
Well, you know, there's the 5-second delay, but when that's if somebody swears or says something.
Right.
But when you stumble like that, you can't, you know, the 5-second delay is not going to help you.
And you can't, you just can't help, you know, help each other. And that's why they do a lot of these, I think, while they do a lot with those pairs all the time. So if one gets stuck, the other one can try to help them. I don't know. Live TV and live theater, they always say all these actors is so invigorating because you tell me, because you see you're in front of the audience and what happens, what can happen, what can't happen, right?
Right, right. But when you're up there alone, like he was, or when you're left alone, like Christopher Walken was, it's painful.
Oh, it's lonely up there. It was certainly lonely for Steve Harvey this year at the Miss Universe.
Miss Universe 2015 is Colombia. I have to apologize. The first runner-up is Colombia. Miss Universe 2015 is Philippines.
Oh.
You know, why didn't they just have them share it? What was the big deal at that point?
Because she didn't win it. I mean,
I know, but
share it because this guy got the name
wrong? He screwed up, so give it to them both.
Oh, it was...
But do you read, there was a story about the Academy Awards, you know, when what's... Of course, I can't remember the actress's name, but she was in My Cousin Vinny.
Right.
And she won an award for Best Actress that year, but the strong rumors were that they read the wrong winner, and she did not actually win, but they just kept it that way.
Oh, I didn't know that.
As opposed to going back like Steve Harvey did. Whoa, sorry! Yeah, of course. I now I have to look up her name.
Marissa Tomei.
Yes.
But Steve Harvey.
That was, wow.
He went on and on. There was a lot of other angst from the audience that I cut out. And at the end, he apologized, said to hold it against the women and so forth. He since has gotten a couple of television commercials I've seen.
Oh, definitely. Making fun of himself.
Yeah. Right. But right. Poor guy. Wow. And then other things can happen live, like Grease, which was very well received recently. But I don't know what it was because it was raining that day. I don't know what it was, but the sound was not good for Hopelessly Devoted when that was performed. Let's try to listen to this if you hear static.
Guess mine is not the first heartbroken. My eyes are not the first to cry.
He held kind of muffled.
Mm-hmm.
All the audiences, not the audience, all the performers are being muffled and staticky and all that. She was performing like, you know, this is her signature song. This is her claim to fame. She did it beautifully.
Right.
But, you know, the engineering didn't work. I don't know if it was the microphone that was on in her blouse that was rushing.
Same thing with Adele at the Grammys when the mic fell in the piano and it sounded like some really bad guitar strumming in the background.
And
it completely threw her off. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. She didn't blame anybody but herself, but you probably was the accompaniment that messed her up, right?
Yeah.
So that's what happens on live TV, but that's kind of the fun of it too. And that might be some of the reason why it's coming back, to give us a little punch in the arm. Carrie Underwood brought back the first of these in The Sound of Music on NBC. We'll be right back after this. I mean, she's not an innovator, but she did take upon the first of these to do a live
Carrie Underwood. Yeah.
On Sound of Music. She has a tremendous voice. I think she did a nice job with it. I don't love the play, and that could be part of the reason why, in my thoughts, it's not such a great thing. But it was the first of these plays, and I think it's great. Even if they're older plays, they certainly have to be plays that are not on Broadway anymore. You know,
you can't start cannibalizing your current Broadway.
Yeah, you're not going to do that with Les Mis, let's say, even though there was a movie that everybody in the country's seen it. So when you come to New York, you're not going to want to see it again.
We should do an Everything Old is New Again live.
We do it every week. We do it live.
How about on Broadway? Let's do it on Broadway.
I would do a Broadway show. Absolutely.
Live on Broadway. Live TV broadcast of a Broadway performance of our radio show.
Why not? Bob and Ray did it.
Really?
We did a discussion of Bob and Ray.
A lot of people are saying you and I are the new Bob and Ray.
I would tend to agree with you about that. It doesn't mean that...
Just to be clear, by a lot, you and me. So,
correct.
There you go.
And Mike, our engineer, says that.
I don't think he does. No.
We give him the accolades on the air.
Same with her. Yeah, sure.
Mike, are we the next Bob and Ray?
Oh, absolutely.
There you go, see? Now I owe him a bottle of wine, but okay, I will be good for that. That promise that the accolades we get is rewarded or are rewarded. And if you want to give us accolades, feel free to send a note to everythingoldisnewagain.biz. You can listen to our old show about Bob and Ray. When Bob Elliott passed away, we got quite a number of hits on our old performance of that show when we talked about him and his career with his partner. Anyway, welcome to Everything Old is New Again. We will be back to talk about today and what's happening with live TV today and what's the future. There she is.
This is Everything Old is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
Queen Latifah, Mary J. Blige, Common, Neo, David Alan Greer, Elijah Kelly, Shanice Williams, Amber Riley, Stephanie Mills, and Uzo Aduba.
There is no place like home.
Come on! The Wiz Live, December 3rd on NBC.
Now that was well received. This is Douglas Viviani with David Cohen on Everything Old is New Again. We're talking about live television, and that was well received.
It was,
and
The Wiz,
I think it was well done, and that was on NBC. So there's now NBC and Fox are doing these. I haven't seen any other stations do the live plays yet.
No, but I think there'll be more. And I think, do you remember the show ER? They did a live TV show, a live episode of ER, and that was pretty well publicized before. And apparently it went off. It was flawless. And it was really cool for the actors to do because a lot of them, you know, came up in the theater. So I have a feeling it's going to spread to, you know, not just doing Broadway shows live, but doing normal shows, you know, serials. Like
I'd even like to see live plays, 12 Angry Men or whatever.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
That really is because there's an intimacy. What would you say? There's something about when the performance is live, not just that, oh, geez, something could go wrong, but the actor is more invigorated, I think, right? You tell me, you've been on stage, you get more energy, right?
Absolutely. It's so much more rewarding. You have to, film is a very, very like up close type of acting, you know. But when you're on a stage, you can act, you know, naturally more physical. It's just more visceral, and it's much more fun to do, as far as I'm concerned. Well, I think also, a lot of actors feel that way.
Also, something we go harken back to Andy Kaufman when he was on Fridays and did what he did and threw the script away and said, I can't do this for a reaction, whether it was real or not. Should those people on acting with him or supposed to act with him had their improv hat on, how do you think, or what would they have done? Like, it's a little different reaction. They didn't do anything, and it was awkward and silent. But if that was you doing improv, let's say, what could you have done with Andy Kaufman?
Yeah, well, the golden rule of improv is yes and, meaning that whatever your partner, your scene partner does, you acknowledge it and you go with it. So, I mean, that's like the first rule you learn. So when Andy Kaufman did that, I mean, if they were doing improv on stage and it wasn't necessarily scripted like it was, you know, the other actors should just say, yeah, me too. Yeah, throw the script up in the air, put your feet on the table, and sort of see where that goes.
And do anything. You could say, oh, yeah, you know what, me too. I'm not into the drugs, but you know what, how about some wine or something? Or whatever, right. Go with it and try to like diffuse his uncomfortable presentation. You know?
Exactly.
Him
exactly.
Saying he can't do it. Instead of unfortunately, those actors did nothing, and the clip is much longer than I did, and none of them, except for Michael Richards at the end, got the cue card, threw it on the table, got a big laugh, but he was upset. He did it
out of anger.
Was something. He's a little more improv than these other ones. Obviously, they didn't have they just kept repeating what Andy Kaufman was saying, and it wasn't like you said, yes and theory. They could have gone with it. I don't know. I know that to give them the benefit of the doubt, they weren't expecting this.
Even in sketch comedy, which that was, things are going to go wrong, right? And it's always, even if, when you watch Saturday Night Live now, something goes wrong in a sketch. Somebody, you know, cracks up or forgets a line or something. It's a team, and nobody gets upset, and you go along with it, you make fun of it, or you just move along with it.
Right. The show must go on.
Exactly.
As did in Grease, I don't know if you know this, Vanessa Hudgens was playing one of the parts. Her dad had passed away the night or the day before the performance, and then listen to what she, I think this is unbelievable, listen to what she did.
I could stay home.
To me, she was an unknown. I don't know if you're familiar with her or anybody is. She looks familiar, but she's unknown.
For your generation, yes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But listening to that live performance of her singing quality blew me away. And I think you can get, they say Britney Spears is overdubbed a lot. And a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of machinations and engineering going on with
you
recording.
You can't do that with a live
music.
Performance, right?
You got to have the talent.
Right.
And I don't mean to go off, but I mean, I've only heard her sing that one song, really. But I mean, that to me was amazing. It was a showstopper.
You have to be a good singer if you're going to sing on Broadway or, you know, on a televised Broadway show. You can't get around it.
I mean, that was...
So that's another cool thing about live TV of a Broadway show. And we're maybe even a play. We've touched on that before, but yeah.
Very emotional, very well done. And again, she did that, you know, the show must go on, right? Unfortunately, her dad passed away the day before.
Right.
And then talk about emotions, Dancing with the Stars. There's a lot of examples, but I'll throw Bindi Irwin in there and her live performance last year.
And that dance was breathtaking.
Baby, it was dancing with you every step of the way. He's proud of you, and the world is proud of you.
The way you dance is that every time I watch you dance,
I feel like I'm watching the way you live your life, right? And it's such an honor to see such a bright light dance with so much beauty and passion. Well done.
Now, I think some of the beauty of Dancing with the Stars, and I'm a big fan because I love family entertainment, but I also, I've never liked dancing ever. And this show has gotten me on that, I don't know, that as a fan, in that, of course, the live happens. People have fallen. People have had mistakes happen.
Right.
Not that you want to see that on purpose, but you see what they do.
Marie Osmond fainted on live TV.
That's a great one. Yeah. Exactly. And then you see some once or twice or maybe three times a season, you'll see a very emotional performance from dancing. And who would have thought dancing can bring out emotions? I, as an uneducated viewer of dancing, you know, could care less and never thought about that. But wow, what an art form when it's done well, contemporary dance or whatever, and you tell a story with dance. And in that story, she was telling a story of her dad, Bindi Irwin's, you know, dad passed away.
Steve Irwin, right.
Steve Irwin, at a very young age, and very moving. Anyway, I think live TV created that environment.
Definitely.
That sea for her to swim in, which is not really
felt real. You know, when it's an edited show, like sometimes, and something happens naturally, but it gets edited later, you lose the freshness of it.
Yeah, I mean, if they could redo the dance and do it over and over again until they got the dance they wanted, let's say, it's not as emotional. It's not going to happen.
Right.
This person's right there live. You know, Jerry Springer did a dance, could kind of barely dance, but he did it for his daughter. And there was some circumstance there. I forget what it was, but at the end goes to the daughter and, you know, brought tears.
Is it live television? It shows the flaws and it shows the humanity of people, and it's much better, I think, than these glossed over reality shows where everything is heavily edited and
exactly. And Chris Daughtry gives you a little piece of that, is why he was involved with The Passion. He was, of course, on American Idol, didn't win it, but is parlayed that, and that was on March of this past year, The Passion, which was live and he was performing.
As a musician, there's always songs that, you know, you hear and go, I wish I wrote that, you know, and so it's fun to sing songs that you respect and love. That never really changes when you become a songwriter.
All right, so, you know, why, in other words, just changing gears a little bit, why would you want to do live television? It's different than a live stage. You've got those, even if it's 1,000 in the audience, it's only 1,000 people, so to speak.
Right.
If you kind of not doing the right thing, live television, look what happened with what we just saw with Travolta and Steve Harvey. No one saw Steve Harvey live doing that, but wow, it spread.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, everyone
these
on the
days.
Planet knows what happened, a mistake he made, right?
Instantly, right.
So when you're doing and signing up to do these live performances too, it's a little trepidation there. You got to have a little of that Peter O'Toole in you, like, that's going to spill out into what you get. I better get this right, you know?
Right, right.
But that's fun. That's what we do on this show. What do you think of, I mean, we are live. We could tell you, we never go back and edit. You could probably tell that.
No, we don't.
We just go from start to finish, even with the edits, I should say, with the clips and so forth. Maybe someday we'll talk about how we do the show, but the point being that we're basically live. Of course, some places it might be on a tape, but it's right to the tape.
Well, let me ask you, if it's right to the tape, but if we were actually going out live over the air, do you think your mindset would be a little differently knowing that that's happening?
It isn't, because we've been trained in now. There's one time, and you'll hear it on one of our shows, where I said, oh, we didn't start out right, let me start again. And you wouldn't let me do that, if you remember. I think it was one of the Broadway shows or something. I can't remember exactly what it was. But you could hear me saying, oh, let's start that over again. Maybe it had been the Disney show. And you said, no, that's good. So my mindset is full steam ahead, because I always stumble over words and once in a while say the wrong word. If I thought that we could edit it, you know, I would do that. But that mindset is gone. Right now, we are of the mindset that this is live, and that's Everything Old Is New Again.
Yeah, it's cool. I like it.
Hopefully you like it on Everything Old Is New Again. Come on back next week. We'll have some more fun. Live to tape, if you will.
Live to tape.
All right, so we're back for that one little minute for LI News Radio, and I think we've explained a little bit about the live performance here. We've also seen that with our game show we did, and Loretta and you.
That was cool.
And the first 10 minutes was kind of a miss, if you will, and then it started to gain steam, and it
how about
it worked.
The food eating contest we had? That was pretty. We had no idea what was going to happen.
Right, and that's
nothing did happen, but you know, we could have.
We're always expecting something to happen. lightning might strike twice. You never know, but that's the fun of it. And we're trying to just bring some fun back to the radio, and hopefully you're enjoying it. Please write to us, let us know, and write to your radio stations, let them know that you're enjoying Everything Old Is New Again. Come on back next week. Everything old is new again.